We all know that the Doha round has not been delivering on what it should deliver. Many of you probably also know that the WTO did deliver in times of crisis, where I think some protectionist attitudes have been minimized. So it's not all black and it's not all white, but it's a good moment in time and a good place to have a debate on how can we now manage the global architecture on trade and investment to deliver to everyone, also the poorest. Now, one of the issues that I see in the way that we are dealing with this now is that global value chains are not really addressed in the WTO multilateral framework. While those global value chains offer a wonderful opportunity for countries to diversify their economies, to add value to the richness of their resources, and to create jobs for their people. So whatever we do, I would suggest that we try and come up with ideas to include these new developments into the global trade and investment architecture. Now, the Netherlands has been an open trading country forever, and we have been greatly benefiting from the multilateral system. And we also put a lot of value on the multilateral system because it should be transparent, there's a level playing field, and as a small country, we benefit from that. And I do think that the multilateral approach is and remains to be the best approach. However, looking at the challenges that we see now and the way that this multilateral system is not really geared towards bringing in these new, so very relevant issues, I think we also need to come up with different scenarios, not so much alternatives, but add-ons, I would suggest, to this multilateral approach. And one of them, of course, could be working in a much more plurilateral approach. Having said that, that approach should be very open and transparent. Everyone should be able to see what's going on there, but also it should be very inclusive. Everyone should be able to take part in those plurilateral groupings that you might have. Now, last September, we decided as an international community on the global goals. We are going to end extreme poverty in 2030. That's only 15 years from now. And all of us looking around the room will probably be here to make that happen. I think we need to really include the global goals perspective in our trade and investment agenda. How can the trade and investment agenda help to achieve those global goals? But also, how can the WTO help in monitoring progress on trade and investment issues that are part of the global goals? So for me, I would suggest for the WTO, that's a real strong and important multilateral agenda that they should push for. Now, maybe a few words then also on investment. I know, and I know some of you were there, that investment issues within the WTO framework have been a bit difficult to address. Let me be diplomatic here. But I do think that we need to address them. And if it's too complicated to do it within the WTO, let's challenge ourselves to come up with other processes that are, again, very inclusive. What I would suggest is that we have made, in the EU, we have made some progress on investment issues that could benefit the larger global architecture. We came up with a new investment protection scheme, not the closed shop that we had with ISDS, but a new system, the ICS, the Investment Court System, which I would specially recommend to my Canadian colleague. I'm sure he also loves it and wants it to be part of the EU-Canada trade agreement. So That's a global, we would like to set a global standard with that, and we're very much looking forward to have a debate with many of you on how that system could and should work. My second suggestion in terms of investment would be we need an investment facilitation program. And that program should be something like aid for investment. It should be about practical issues to help everyone to integrate in this global investment push that we are seeing, making sure that these investments are sustainable, that they uphold all the social standards that all of us want to uphold, but also that they deliver to everyone. Those practical issues that can be addressed are, I mean, not too complicated in a political sense. It's making sure that there's open and accessible information on investments, that there's a promotion, that we set up promotion agencies, that we help countries to use investments to integrate backwards and forwards into those global value chains, and many other more practical issues that I really would love to hear from the floor later on that you see as viable as part of that agenda. So in summing up, I would say let's continue to make good use of the WTO. Let's put multilateralism first. Let's look at alternative scenarios to push the issues that are now holding us hostage and preventing us from delivering to the poorest. Let's use the global goals as a framework and ask WTO to play a role in it, and let's work on a new investment agenda that delivers to all. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Well, that has set the table with some very exciting and ambitious notions. Minister Lembong, over to you. There's quite a robust agenda of integration in your region right now. How do you see the international agenda interacting with your regional dynamics?
Thank you, Richard. I would certainly agree that it's a fascinating time to be meeting, and potentially even a historic time. I would just highlight two recent developments. One is the completion of TPP. You know, in my personal opinion, it's actually a historic achievement. I think everyone is quite stunned and surprised. I think, frankly, 3 or 4 months ago, most people would have agreed such a thing would not be possible. But it has happened. And in my view, it is a game changer. The second development I would highlight is the November 30 declaration by the International Monetary Fund, including the Chinese currency, the renminbi, in the exclusive club of global currencies. So it has now been anointed only the fifth global reserve currency alongside the US dollar, the euro, the Japanese yen, and the pound sterling. And it's the first birth of a new global currency since the euro was born in 1999. Now, I think Nairobi this week is very, very interesting. We definitely are at a crossroads. Not just in terms of the multilateral trading system, but I think economically, like the world economy is at a crossroads. Clearly, the developed economies are recovering and even strengthening. US economy is clearly recovering very strongly. That's why the American Central Bank is getting ready this week to raise interest rates. That has caused the value of the dollar to climb, to increase precipitously. My personal view is that Europe is also recovering very, very nicely, which is impressive considering that only 4 years ago we were in the midst of the European sovereign debt crisis. And that actually contains an interesting lesson for me. You know, the European sovereign debt crisis 4 years ago finally pushed many European governments to implement painful and controversial reforms. And it's only taken 3 years for these economies to then rebound and now to be growing strongly. Yeah. Now back to Nairobi this week. Indonesia is kind of an interesting position. It's advanced enough to be a member of the G20, but it very clearly is also a developing country. And Indonesia chairs this forum called the G33, which is entirely developing countries. I've now been in my job for about 4 months, so it's all very new and interesting to me. I hope to bring the benefit of a fresh perspective to this week's proceedings. Just to share with you all, I was a little bit startled by the discussions in Nairobi so far, including within the G33, and then, you know, other forums like the Cairns Group and so on. I understand that that there's very strong feelings, for example, among developing countries, and also among developed countries. And words that I've been hearing this week in Nairobi are like frustration and disappointment, and so on. Now, coming at it with a fresh perspective, I ultimately concluded, to me right now, what's more important is the constructive and positive relationship between developed and developing countries. You know, I'm actually worried about the tone, more so than substance. You know, I almost start to not care so much about the substance, and that might be a startling statement, but in my view, where we are as a world economy right now with a divergence between the rich countries, economy strengthening, and emerging markets clearly in a downturn, I think the last thing we need is acrimony between the two camps, right, as we battle over Doha round and so on. So, look, we in Indonesia, and especially this current government, we tend to be very pragmatic. And so I felt compelled to highlight that we are in the midst of an emerging markets downturn. You know? And so, in my view, it's incumbent upon us, emerging markets, to put forward a positive, constructive, even professional attitude, and refrain, if you will, from excessively strident or emotional rhetoric, if you will. I think with the downturn, and linking this back to what I mentioned just now about the sovereign debt crisis in Europe, you know, look, I think it's an opportune time for us, the emerging markets, developing countries, to take a very long, hard look in the mirror, to be honest. You know, we should look again. I think the reality is that many of us, including my own country, Indonesia, you know, we still have arguably outdated views. Like, we still have too many protectionist measures. We still have too much bureaucracy and overregulation and red tape, which is hampering the flow of goods and capital that we need, right? And we sometimes have this tendency to blame the international system or to call the situation unfair. But again, I think the downturns are always an opportunity to look at reforms. You know, it's very hard to implement reforms when you're in a boom or when times are flush, right? But again, look at Europe. Only 4 years ago was in crisis. They implemented painful, controversial, but far-reaching reforms, and only 3 years later, you know, rebounding and growing strongly. I think our goal as Indonesia here this week is to strongly urge a sense of moderation and reasonableness, and a positive tone. I think, you know, that's what, in our view, is called for at this juncture.
Thank you. Thanks for those very wise and much appreciated words as we enter a few days of rather intense discussions with a lot at stake. Ambassador Fried, can we turn to you now to offer your thoughts as to what needs to be tackled by the multilateral system over the next decade, and how one might be able to pivot from where we are today toward accomplishing some of the things that Minister Plutman mentioned earlier.
Rick, thanks, and I'll try to build on the wise words of the two ministers. Let me say two things at the outset, though. Number one, I'm not going to talk about this week, and I'll be pulled back into some meetings maybe even before the end of the session, so I apologize about that. Second, as you would expect any good bureaucrat to say, the views expressed are about to be my own and do not necessarily reflect government positions. You asked at the outset to think about the next decade and to dovetail with some of the impressive E15 work. So let me offer four baskets of issues that I think inevitably will be on our agenda regardless of the outcome this week. The first basket is the accumulated set of issues that we've inherited from the Uruguay round that remain on the table at Nairobi in the Doha development agenda. That obviously includes a number of agricultural related issues, including most importantly domestic support. We still have a world that is populated with tariff peaks, with vast gaps between bound tariffs on the books versus applied tariffs. So there's still old-fashioned market access issues to deal with. Services, which was brought into the WTO framework in the Uruguay round, is quite underdeveloped in terms of ensuring a level playing field for developing as well as developed countries, as well as the two ministers articulated well, figuring out how to do this in a development friendly fashion. So with or without clear direction from the ministers this week, these issues are on the agenda for members of the WTO. We must be doing something right, I dare say, because we will be celebrating the accession of Kazakhstan, the completion of accession procedures by Liberia and Afghanistan this week. And we have about two dozen other countries lined up wanting to join. And if we were doing such a terrible job, why do people want to join the club? They all see it as a being of potential benefit. In the meantime, the WTO will continue to bless and to encourage plurilateral agreements within the WTO framework. The government procurement agreement is a great success in providing governments with the ability to obtain goods and services at lower cost, more bang for the buck, in a non-discriminatory way. Work is proceeding on modernizing on an MFN, most favored nation basis, open to the world, free trade and information technology products. We're trying to move an agenda forward to create lower cost, better quality goods from the world on environmental goods. As well. Second basket, as the ministers noted and Rick noted in his introduction, the world is a heterogeneous place when it comes to trade. The notion of regionalism versus multilateralism is a false dichotomy. We've always had a system whereby bilateral, regional, and now mega-regional agreements have successfully coexisted with the multilateral system and can and should reinforce each other. Way back during the Uruguay round, when it looked like the Uruguay round was stalled, Canada, the United States, and Mexico completed NAFTA negotiations. Lo and behold, within 2 years, many of those disciplines showed up in a multilateral context in the end result of the Uruguay round. TPP may well provide some inspiration, some catalytic guidance as to the kinds of things the multilateral system can do. And that notion is, of course, repeated. I don't mean to sound geographically biased in focusing on TPP. We have RCEP underway. We have the ASEAN Economic Community. We have a fresh look here in Africa on a pan-African ambitious agenda as well. So each of these is seen not as a replacement for, but as a complement to the multilateral system. That means we better make sure that what we're doing regionally remains compatible. There's a responsibility within the WTO through its Committee on Regional Trade Agreements to actually exercise some quality control and vigorous review. The OECD is doing some good analytical work on the so-called deep integration provisions that we're beginning to see appear in RTAs. UNCTAD doing some work as well. So there is some forward work ahead, including from the outside public policy community, to help us think through how to ensure these agreements remain compatible with each other. Third basket of issues is a big basket. What is it that business, who are the creators of jobs, who actually help to distribute wealth more equitably and to be more inclusive, what is it that business needs to do business in the 21st century? Minister Plowman rightly highlighted the reality of global and, may I add, regional value chains. What we see as trade has leveled off, trade no longer, according to recent statistics, outpaces GDP. Maybe it's being replaced by local production. You invest first, and instead of importing all your parts, you line up your local suppliers. If that's the case, how do we create the rules that help foster that integration of trade among affiliated, not common-owned, but affiliated companies who are part of long-term supply networks? That does mean bringing investment into the mix. So we need to understand that better. It means, and I can never pronounce the word because it's a Swedish import into the English language, the servification of trade. Behind the sale of any good lies affiliated services. If I'm going to sell something to you across borders, I probably need a lawyer, an accountant, a transporter, a factor, customs broker, and so on. Those are all services. Those are all jobs, too. We don't measure that well. We don't factor that in as negotiators. We think in last century terms that all that counts is the merchandise, and we need to give ourselves credit for the job creation that goes with the affiliated services, and maybe most importantly, the financial services, as people need to bank themselves. The advent of the digital economy, and Klaus Schwab of the World Economic Forum has called it nothing less than the fourth industrial revolution. Take the micro-enterprise dimension. eBay demonstrates that a single person producing goods can, him or herself, by posting on eBay for the grand total of 10 cents, export to 100 different countries. Do we actually have the rules to help facilitate that person's access to global markets? Do we have rules for consumer protection? Do we have rules to facilitate payment and collection? We haven't paid enough attention to that dimension. And at the mega level, if business needs to keep inventory across borders, if we're in a world of B2B, if we're even into the Internet of Things and 3D printing, where the design takes place in one country, but the good comes out the other end without ever crossing a border, do our trade rules take account of that? Probably not. But what we are seeing in a TTIP context, more than a TPP context, is the first signs of a profound discussion as to how to reconcile the needs of business with the needs of privacy in the individual and the needs to protect ourselves from harm through cybersecurity measures as well. That's an issue not just for Europe and the United States, an issue for the world. The WTO has long had a work program on e-commerce, so-called, an outdated term. We need to update and broaden our work in a WTO context to do that. State capitalism is a reality, whether we're talking about, and I'm not singling any country out, but Petronas in oil and gas, for example, or if we look at China and its state-owned enterprises. What does that mean in terms of conditions of competition across borders? So we need to deal a bit more, and we anticipated this as long ago as Singapore in 1996, we need to deal with competition and trade. Good scholarship, no WTO discussions yet on the subject. Recent disputes have highlighted the need, and Paris reminds us of the needs to deal with trade and the environment, and to deal with trade and the flip side, which is trade and energy and raw materials. How do we ensure that the trade rules foster sustainable development that's pro-environment? how do we do so in a manner that ensures adequate energy supply at the same time? Final dimension, coming full circle to Minister Plowman, is trade and development. And here, let me be a bit provocative. The WTO should not be the center of that discussion. All the free trade in the world will not generate sustainable development on whatever pro-development terms we may set in the WTO, unless it's accompanied by the kinds of structural reforms enabling environment domestically of good regulation, of fostering and bringing in SMEs and the job creators that are the responsibility, first, of the host government, secondly, of the donor community, and thirdly, of the development-oriented institutions ranging from the World Bank and its regional cousins to bilateral donors. We have failed to date to ensure coherence between the promotion of a trade liberalization agenda with the domestic capacity building that needs to go with it. How do we better, going forward, bring together the relevant players and the relevant international institutions beyond the WTO to ensure that we're calibrating the liberalization and sequencing it in a manner that moves forward with the capacity of the developing country to move into a supply chain global environment? That's a discussion that needs to take place among the international institutions, among the donors, and between the donor and developing country community. And that's many more players than we have here in Nairobi today. That's what I think the long-term agenda is. Patrick and others no doubt will tell us the architecture needed to achieve that.
Patrick, you need no further introduction.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the invitation. And these are rather hard acts to follow. I thought what I would do is simply refer to three things that I've been giving some thought to over the years, which I think are at the heart of some of the challenges that the system is facing. So they're very WTO-oriented, they're very medium to long-term in terms of their relevance, but I think they help to explain some of the issues we're facing now in the present. The first is about plurilateralism. The second will be about the distinctions between developing and developed countries. And the third is about the role of the WTO as an agent of trade liberalization. So very quickly, plurilateralism, I think we have to be very clear what we mean by this, because there are really two brands of plurilateral approaches. One is discriminatory and the other is not. If you go down the discriminatory road, you're going to change the face of the institution. And I don't know what odds one would give to the survival of the institution under those circumstances. You would certainly have to dispense with consensus decision making. But there is another way where you can harvest the fruits of a plurilateral approach and keep the institution intact. Now, of course, even this approach, which sometimes is referred to as the critical mass approach, has its enemies, because you've got to think about this in terms of how much access do you have to these so-called plurilateral approaches. I mean, the way that the services, the extra WTO services negotiations are going is a good example. This is not open house for anyone who wants to be part of it, and that is a problem. So I think there's only one agreement in the WTO of any significance that is discriminatory plurilateral, and that's the government procurement agreement. And the reason that was possible, this happened in the Tokyo round, the reason that was possible is because the GATT agreement had explicitly excluded procurement from its coverage. And so if procurement wasn't in, and some countries wanted to bring it in, it was quite hard to say, oh, we can't be... That's why it was able to be discriminatory. It's not ideal, but certainly it's gone much further than it would have if it had not been discriminatory. And that's, of course, the tension. But so that, of course, raises another question about what is the role of the WTO in the bigger picture. And so I very much subscribe to the idea that the WTO is one part of a global architecture, and it doesn't do enough to feed off and cooperate with the other parts. For developed and developing countries, if you were to try to analyze every single difficulty that the WTO faces, every single negotiating bind it is in, you'd almost always find that the root of it was at the margin of definition and distinction between developing and developed countries. And there are many manifestations of this. Increasingly, you hear smaller developing countries that are not LDCs, not least developed countries, complaining that the emerging economies are making their lives difficult. Industrial countries are typically saying the same thing about the emerging economies, and the emerging economies are saying, wait a minute, I am not. I am China, I am big, I am India, I am big. It doesn't mean I don't have a soft underbelly of vulnerability when it comes to development. So how can we nuance this and get away from a world in which stating your status and insisting on your status becomes the end game? Because it's where we get stuck. This is a really hard nut to crack. First of all, attitudes are really bad. And so you can't get people to have a serious conversation about this. But it seems to me that one way through this would be to stop worrying about the status of countries, but and start worrying about the status of economies in different sectors. We should go issue-wise on this instead of nation-wise, because it's the nation-wise thing that kills it. Of course, China and India and others definitely would be in the same camp as the industrial nations when it comes to particular sectors and particular activities, but by no means in other ones. But yet that conversation doesn't take place. So I think that we just need a... But this will only happen if the bad attitudes start to get modified. And I don't know how that is going to happen, as the political scientists. The final thing I wanted to mention is that I actually think that historically, the GATT-WTO has somewhat misspecified its effectiveness in terms of functions. It is not a good agent of trade liberalization. Certainly not trade liberalization at the border. If you actually take the record apart, it's highly attenuated in terms of what has been achieved. Industrial tariffs in industrial countries, certainly in the early years of the WTO, no developing country other than in a accession negotiation or in the information technology agreement has ever lowered an applied tariff on the altar of a GATT or WTO negotiation, ever. Now, why is that? It's not because they haven't opened up their economies. It's because they don't like the institutional framework of the GATT-WTO. So we've thought really hard about why that is. And basically, it seems to turn on the following. When the GATT was created in the late 40s, it was a series, fundamentally, it was a series of large countries trying to disassemble what they'd put up in the 30s and during the Second World War. And they were worried, they were genuinely worried, I've seen references to this, they were genuinely worried about the terms of trade implications of unilateral liberalization, because they had big domestic markets. If you have a big domestic market and you liberalize unilaterally, you will be turning the terms of trade against you. So and that's not a good thing, obviously, if you can avoid it. So they said, well, we won't just make this a non-discriminatory organization, we'll also make it reciprocal. So you have MFN and reciprocity. This is fine amongst similar countries, but it becomes a problem when countries are very different. So when developing countries started to come into the system and started to try to negotiate or were invited to negotiate or asked to negotiate, we always got the same problem, is that a large country wouldn't negotiate with a small country because of the free rider problem given the MFN. So the small country couldn't give reciprocity to the large one. The time that this hit me the hardest was when I had left the GATT and was working as a consultant and was working for the Mexican government, and the Mexicans were changing their whole policy stance. and asked the United States for a deal. They came with requests and offer lists in the old GATT style and said, let's do it. And the Americans, it was like music to their ears. But they said no, because that means the Japanese and the Europeans will get it for nothing. So the Mexicans had to go away again and ask for a regional agreement, which for them was quite a tough ask, given the history and the politics. But they did it. And that made me think much harder about what this problem is. So I think that the WTO would be usefully focused less on liberalizing trade. I mean, if you look at the Doha round, it is more intensive in trade liberalization than practically any round we've ever had. And I think, in part, that explains why we're stuck. So consolidation, rulemaking, dispute settlement seemed to me the real strong suit of the WTO, and focusing on that strong suit would be a lot better than trying to liberalize trade amongst parties that are fundamentally unwilling to do it. Why do they do it in, why did Colombia do what it did with the United States? The chief negotiator used to be the ambassador in Geneva, and I used to have lots of conversations with him about it. And he said, I gave up, in that negotiation, I gave the Americans a hell of a lot that I would never give in the WTO. And the reason is I actually got reciprocity. I got free trade. So I think this is something that is well worth thinking about as an option towards tilting the balance of priorities and understanding better what the true strengths and contribution of the WTO could be.
Thank you. Now, over to you, Ricardo. Offer your thoughts. I mean, you have been running an international think tank, thinking about these issues across the board and through the lens of many countries over the years, but you're also an emerging market former trade official. So it'd be interesting to hear your perspective.
Thank you, Rick. I think, the reason I've been doing this for so many years, it's clear in the statements that we just heard. It's these are very difficult and complex problems that are fascinating as well, but they're also absolutely essential for the way in which we conduct business today, for the functioning of the world economy, and for everybody's day-to-day lives. So already it's been very rich what we have heard. I was asked to be sort of a discussant to what has heard. Let me maybe pick up three or four of the themes. One is that it's absolutely clear that what we have in front of us is a great moment to take advantage of and try to update and try to bring into more coherence or coherence the kind of messy global trade and investment architecture that has evolved through the past 60 years in a very organic manner as a sort of a maze. When you do the mapping, and we did that in the E15 process of the global trade and investment architecture, what you find is that the articulation of the various pieces is not that clear. It does really, it reflects that there's no vision that it can be aligned along with, and it even has many complications when it comes to the articulation of that global trade investment architecture and other governance mechanisms that we have today. So this crisis, if that's what some people call it, and in the multilateral trade system as we come to Nairobi, comes also at a time, as Minister Plowman said, when the international community has made some decisions on what kind of values and what kinds of ambition it should drive international cooperation. And we need to make sure that, again, in upgrading and making sure that there's coherence in that global trade investment system, we do pay attention to those undertakings. So I see any outcome of Nairobi as a really great possibility, is really a great opportunity to one way or another way get into reforms that are really urgent so that we can have less friction in the global economy, we can have a better delivery of private goods but also of public and social goods that are expected from that global economy and from the frameworks that govern that global economy. Now, more to specifics. The question that Patrick just raised and was also mentioned by all the speakers before, which is where is trade policy happening, and particularly how is this very rapid and increasing integration of global economies into global markets, how is it that this is happening? It's very interesting. I mean, people think that in the WTO, when you talk to the public, there is a crisis, that there's a crisis in world trade, that things have slowed down. When we, working in this area, know that we're actually living through very exciting times. There's never been so much activity. I mean, officials in ministries of trade, they can't really have the capacity to deal with all the various fronts that they have in front of them, because everybody's busy integrating. And I think that the one word that I want to leave in your minds there is that this is about integration. Trade liberalization, it's a means to that integration. This is about the integration of economies into a global economy, of national economies into a global economy, of businesses, of consumers, into that global economy. And so what we need is a positive agenda, again, that supports that further global integration with that normative approach of what is it that it has to deliver. It has to deliver jobs, it has to deliver economic inclusiveness, inclusion, it has to deliver sustainability in the management of resources. For that, we need in the WTO a recognition of what is its role. The WTO, whatever happens here, is not going to lose the fundamental role that it has in the global economy. Every other piece of integration, whether it's a bilateral or a mega-regional, really takes place against that backdrop of infrastructure that has been provided by the WTO. It's true that if it doesn't update itself, it's going to end up exhausting its possibilities, including in the functions that Patrick has called for in dispute settlement, in the rulemaking, because it has to respond to the issues of today, and it's behind those issues, partly because it's been so busy caught up in this negotiation of the Doha Development Agenda. So, again, whether governments decide today, and this is from an observer that it's a few meters above what is happening, including on the various interests that are at play and in those negotiations, whether they decide to continue with the Doha round of negotiations or whether they decide to call off the Doha round, it would be very important to specify exactly what is it that they mean. But in any of the two scenarios, we're going to see the same agenda going forward. And that agenda going forward, I think, has been very clearly outlined by Ambassador Fried. It is an agenda that requires that the WTO, if it stays with the Doha round negotiations, opens new approaches to address the new issues of the global economy of today. If it decides to suspend those negotiations, it will have to still address many of the issues that are very relevant for that global economy, which are part of the negotiations. And it would have to then, again, bring in the new issues. And one of the most important elements going forward would be to really have a proactive approach to articulating the role of the WTO, of the multilateral trade system, in that regime complex of the RTAs and the mega regionals. Going forward, and this is the exercise that negotiators have to do today, is think about the world of 2025, 2030, 2035. That's what we tried to do with the E15 initiative. Going forward, we have to imagine what is it that is going to happen. How is it that, say, for instance, we may, in a few years, see a world where you have the TPP, you have the transatlantic US-EU TTIP, perhaps bringing in a China and a Brazil, and you have already 80% of global output in that kind of world. But you may have another world where the dynamics of integration in Asia are, in a way, a counterbalance to integration that is happening in the transatlantic space. In any of those, we need to know what is going to happen with Africa, what's going to happen that, with those that are behind. And that role should not be just left to, again, to an organic force to reorganize. There should be a proactive approach to discussing these issues in the only forum that can really discuss them, and that's the WTO. It could be that the G20 and others drive and initiate those kind of discussions. But you need to have a proactive agenda in the WTO on the articulation of the multilateral trade system with the rest of that regime complex on trade and investment. There are very specific proposals that we have made on how to do this, including putting now into an implementation phase an idea that came out from the early discussions of the E15 that we referred to as the RTA exchange, a place where you systematically look at those issues on RTAs, at the coherence of the issues between RTAs, at one of the questions that, again, is demanding a response from the multilateral trade system, which is what to do ex ante about the principles that should inform the participation or not of the non-members of the emerging mega-regionals or the emerging configurations in the global economy that affect them in a major way. So again, I think that one of the things to really bring from here as a message from Nairobi, again, and hopefully it will, that the ears of the negotiators and the WTO will be open to that, is a need to have a very deep structural discussion on that role of the multilateral trade system in the larger system that we have today.
Thanks very much, Ricardo. Now, we've got about 10 or so minutes left. I think Ambassador Fried has to leave just before any of the sessions, so why don't I invite a reaction from you first?
Well, it's not a reaction, but it's a footnote, because I think we do have to face head-on what Minister Plowman started with, which is inclusiveness. And here I'll defer to Patrick and others with deeper history. But historically, the WTO was concerned with the border and simply to ensure that companies and firms could compete with each other. We've moved beyond the border into areas of domestic regulation like non-tariff barriers, like standards and sanitary and phytosanitary measures that strike more closely to the interests of citizens and the population. But the WTO has never purported to say, other than we think on basic economic principle we generate more wealth for more firms than therefore create more jobs, we've never said it's our job to tell you how to distribute that wealth. In effect, it belongs to the national governments through their taxation systems, through their regulatory systems to say, gee, if our companies are making more money, what does that mean for wages? What does that mean for workers? What does that mean for distributing the wealth? That's not a WTO agenda. Take yet another example of that, and Germany, under its G7 chairmanship, held a fascinating ministerial meeting of development and labor ministers, saying, we're all concerned to ensure sustainable supply chains, that there is no race to the bottom in terms of finding low wages or unsafe wage conditions. But we shouldn't allow countries to use that as an excuse for discriminatory or protectionist regulation. Should Canada say, we prefer garments made by blue-eyed people? That's not going to wash and should never be tolerated. And if we have 800 different NGOs, each proposing a different standard, it doesn't help the exporting country to figure out, do I have to meet all 800 of them to have an effective market abroad? How do we ensure level playing field beyond the border? And again, going back to what I tried to say about coherence with other organizations, if we care about fairness and inclusiveness, that means a good dialogue with the ILO, and with UN agencies responsible, so that countries in growing into free trade have a better appreciation of the importance of accompanying policies to better ensure social justice in the distribution of the wealth created by the bigger pie that we know trade creates. I apologize especially to the ministers, but I've got to run.
Thanks very much. Let's pick up on that point, Minister. You know, much of the what we just heard this morning, or this afternoon, I should say, are suggestions to stretch our conception of what the WTO should be doing and how it should be interacting with the rest of the international economic institutional environment. Nowhere more so than in the areas that you and Ambassador Fried have just cited, which is institution building, in order to equip countries that decide for themselves that they want to integrate with international value chains, want to attract more and develop more services, want to build the domestic capability to be able to satisfy requirements of various sorts, both public and private standards and the like. And you yourself at one point said, how do we bring the parties together beyond the trade norm-setting institutions, but very importantly, the development assistance community, which traditionally has not allocated a lot of attention and resources to economic, what I would call economic institution building. And the minister from Indonesia also cited the importance of this. Given your rather central role in your congregation of development ministers, that, and in fact you just hosted, as I recall this year, the summer retreat of development ministers, could you think forward a little bit about how, whether you think there is the space within that community, which is understandably focused often on health issues, on basic education, as to whether we'll get more mind share or more resource share for this kind of very catalytic institution building?
Yeah, thanks. Being the Minister for Aid and Trade, I constantly talk to WTO, ILO, UNDP, and I sometimes tend to forget that there's not many people who have this institutional advantage of talking to and with all the different institutions. So, concerns that the ambassador voiced. I mean, if we want policy space for the Dutch government, my own government, then of course, if we also advocate for policy space for any other government. So it's good to kind of be pushed a little bit on the question of, for those who have not that conversation on a daily basis, what can be done? Now, I would say that within the community of development ministers, there has always been a little bit of a, let me say, difficult or dilemma-driven relation to the trade issues. Evelien Hefkens is sitting on first row here, front row, one of my predecessors. And I know that she has been very instrumental in trying to bring in trade issues into the development agenda. And I think there has been resistance from the two sides. One from the development minister saying, you know, are we bringing private sector interests in? And one from the development ministers, from the trade minister saying, why should we worry about fair distribution of wealth? Now, bringing the two together, I mean, it's not an issue if we want to do this. We have to do it. In all of our countries, all over the world, unemployment for young people is much too high. And if we don't manage to bring jobs to young people, all of us will be facing severe crisis. And we haven't seen anything yet, I would say. So what you see more and more is that on part of the trade ministers, there's a lot of interest on how to make trade more inclusive. We just published a research on how a possible TTIP can bring positive outcomes to developing countries. Not saying how can we minimize negative consequences, but looking into how can we make it more positive. Development ministers as well as trade ministers were very interested in that. So it's a bit about perspective. The second is, if you want to bring in jobs, you need to include the private sector. Now, the development community is very instrumental in doing that in two ways that I would like to point out here. One is a level playing field in terms of transparent rules and regulations and legal frameworks is a good thing for citizens as well as for companies. So it's something that all of us should aspire to. If there is no rule of law, that means that I am suffering, but it also means that a company like Unilever is suffering, and probably a small and medium company run by a few women is suffering the most. So there's a benefit for all of us. Now, if we say that aid for trade is an accepted discourse, if you wish, then aid for investment should also become an acceptable discourse. But we need to bring the perspectives together. The Netherlands will hold the EU presidency the next 6 months, and we will organize a back-to-back meeting of EU trade and development ministers. And I think all of us, and I'm really looking forward to ideas of others also, is we should think clearly about how to bring all people of goodwill in the two domains together, because the WTO is no longer only about tariffs. It has been said earlier. It is about standards, and it should be about standards, but we need democratic legitimacy, I would say, to make sure that it's the right standards and that everyone can benefit. So no clear-cut solution. It's about a mindset that has to drive new institutions or that has to open up some institutions that are already there. And I think we can do it.
I think you're right. I think we heard a great illustration of exactly that mindset from you, Minister Limbong, earlier when you argued that investment climate conditions and effectively investment climate institution building is really quite critical as a prerequisite for being able to take advantage.
Richard, in my mind, there's very little doubt that trade can drive development and also that trade can drive reform. You know, I think, I believe that empirically, factually, if you look at the history of the last 20 or 30 years, I think there would be a very clear pattern that those countries which embrace the most protectionist policies will be the least developed or will have advanced the least. And those countries which have dismantled protectionism and become more open have progressed the most. I believe the factual evidence would show that very few countries succeed over sustainable periods of time pursuing protectionist policies or a closed philosophy towards trade. In that sense, I think trade is also very usefully a symptom. You know, I think if you look at different countries, those who are very open, you know, very modern, very anti-protectionist, if you will, those tend to also be very economically successful, right? Now, in that sense, I think WTO actually has untapped potential. You know, I wish that there was more sharing of success stories in WTO. I wish there was more sharing of, frankly, failure stories. I think there's not, I cannot think of a forum quite like the WTO. For example, if we compare to United Nations. Okay, United Nations meets, what is it, once a year or so on, but it's not as focused on economic matters. You know, it's focused on social, you know, religion, environmental, what have you, but there's nothing quite like the WTO in my mind, you know, where 162 countries meet regularly and it's very focused on economic issues. I think trade is a huge issue, you know, and therefore WTO has so much potential. But it may mean that we need to become less technical, you know, less technical, more, you know, narrative driven, you know, to capture the imagination of the people, you know, and our constituencies back home. We may actually really appreciate Patrick's comment that attitudes are really bad. You know, I think, how do we turn this thing around? I think a big dose of honesty, frankly, would be really helpful. And, you know, sometimes we get trapped in this dynamic. The WTO is kind of the poor countries against the rich countries, and everyone's kind of trapped in this dynamic. Actually, we need to get away from that. you know. And I think just cooling tempers, maybe being more forthright, being more pragmatic, practical. I think those of us who can lead on that front should, right? And I'm a big believer in leadership. I think people, you know, and I'm very heartened because all around the world I see a new generation of leaders coming up, you know? I think this is hopefully very refreshing. And again, I'm fascinated, intrigued by WTO. I think we should forgive the WTO perhaps more for its failings and take a step back and look at what else we can do, you know, on development, investment. I do think it's a very unique forum. There's none quite like it.
Excellent. We have a few minutes left for a couple of quick questions or very short reactions. And if we have a lady here in the front, another in the back, I think the microphones should be appearing shortly for you. Please be brief given the limited amount of time.
Thank you, Eleanor Fox, New York University. Thank you very much. You're looking for coherence for trade competition, trade investment and development. Do you not see that there's a great unspoken issue, except by Ambassador Fried, of competition, which is really markets, when the poorest and most vulnerable are hurt by restraints? They're trade and competition restraints. They might be one, they might be the other, they might be digital economy, they might be global value chain. This is a big missing issue. Do you think there is room for it as you proceed post-Doha? Thank you.
Thanks. Next question.
Good afternoon. My name is Hannes Covedo from ArcelorMittal. First of all, thank you very much for the presentation and the messages. My question is related to the different topics presented on investment by the minister and on trade, and maybe linking it with the conclusion of Professor Lowe. When we talk about investment, we are, as a company like ArcelorMittal, we take a decision whether we invest in a country or whether we trade to a country. And this is based on the competitive advantage that this country brings to us. So my question to us, which is very much linked to what Professor Lowe said, is why you are not discussing the basis of fair trade linked to industrial policy? Free trade without the right level of competitiveness of the domestic industry will kill the industry. If in Europe have decided to move the heavy industry out of the region because you prefer to put regulatory costs instead of developing the right trade or the right trade defense, that's fine. But these are not the same encouragement that has to be given to countries that do need to invest on industrial. So I would appreciate your feedback. Thank you.
Thanks. Anyone else?
Hi there. Just a question. I'm wondering if the panel members had been to China recently, because China, of course, is the most fastest development story in the history of the world, pretty much, and they use all very protectionist measures. And that's not my opinion. That's the U.S. trade representative's opinion. So, anyways. My question is, do you see the contradiction in promoting attacking protectionism so much when China used protectionism in its development currently now very successfully?
Okay, I'm Cheryl and I'm a student and I'm taking international relations and diplomacy, and we take WTO matters serious. So I'm asking, what are the implications of mega trading blocks like WTO in promoting multilateral trading system?
Okay. Why don't you pass the mic just down the road to you? There you go.
Good afternoon. My name is Joseph, and I just want to thank one speaker that talked about bringing to an end the game of calling national economies to regional economies. How can this be realistic in the especially in the African setup? Putting in mind the political structures, the social structure, and the economic structures, how can we bring this to be a realistic kind of economy?
And last question up front here.
Yes, hello. Philippe Borel, Switzerland. Thank you very much. We're co-sponsors, by the way, of the E15 initiative. Thank you to Ricardo Melendez's team for the wonderful wonderful work, to everyone on the panel for the presentations. We feel very strongly about the E15 initiative because we feel it's important to effect change among policy decision makers about the importance of sustainability issues in trade. Perhaps two questions. One to Minister Plowman. The first is that Ambassador Fried said, well, the sustainability issues really don't need to be discussed at WTO. He was being provocative. And he said, rather, it's the trade the aid community that should be dealing with that. How do you respond to that? Do you not feel that, in fact, there should be greater policy coherence across the board? We should be developing these issues at WTO in free trade agreements, as you mentioned, under the presidency, your presidency at the EU, and then perhaps as well to Minister Limbong. How do you see the green growth agenda? How do you implement it in Indonesia? How do you balance, on the one hand, legitimate expectations of the population for rapid growth and rapid change, and on the other hand, mainstreaming at the WTO, for instance, these issues? Is green growth, should it still be a prioritization at WTO? Thank you.
Thanks very much. Apologies to those of you we haven't been able to get to, but I would now invite any of the panelists that wish to respond to one or more of the questions to do so in a minute or two. Any volunteers? Patrick?
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right, Professor Fox, about competition. It's the conditions of competition change every time a government intervenes, and the question is how to do it. The question is, can you simply implant antitrust into an international context? The answer has to be no. So what are we going to do? So I think that I completely agree with that. I just want to say one thing. I want to reinforce what Minister Limbong has been talking about, and others, but especially him. The deliberative functions of the WTO. We really need to pay attention to the deliberative functions. Pascal Lamy used to talk about the missing middle. He used to say, we legislate, we litigate, but what about the in-between? And if we got the in-between right, those two functions would be much strengthened. And I think that's just another point I want to make.
I think a couple of quick answers on China's success with protectionist measures. I would actually argue the opposite. I would actually argue that in those areas where China has been protectionist, they've had massive failures. I personally think that, for example, their vast industrial overcapacity. You know, they have vast stretches of steel mills and other industries which are loss-making and heavily polluting. That's arguably an area where they failed. And I would say that a lot of their success has come from policies which were very open. You know, open to foreign investment, open to importation of parts and components and raw materials. So I would actually argue that that's a good case study for where openness policies have been successful, and the opposite have been unsuccessful, personally. On the question of green growth, to be very honest, I would admit that we have not been successful so far. You know, it's not yet been become a top priority agenda. I think we have many other arguably low-hanging fruits, you know, to deregulate, to debureaucratize, to build infrastructure and so on. However, I would say it's critical. It's of absolutely critical importance. It's widely known, and we share the view that climate change, for example, will hit the poorest the hardest. Indonesia is a tropical country with 70, you know, we're an archipelago of islands with 70,000 miles of coastline, rising sea levels, and so on. Now, there, my personal view is, I pin more of my hopes on technology, frankly, you know, than on top-down systems. I actually think technology offers the best hope to leapfrog a stage of our development that is very polluting or very environmentally irresponsible. I think we can jump straight to solar panels, biomass, and so on, because of technology. Thank you.
Thanks. Ricardo?
Maybe one question that I'd like to pick up, because we're here in Africa, is the question that was just asked about the opportunities for further integration of African countries into regional economies and then the global economy, and what do all this has to do with that. And of course, the frameworks are terribly important, But we all know also that there's a big domestic agenda in Africa, in structural reforms, in infrastructure, at the regional level. We've heard how little there is, how little integration we continue to have among African countries, and how much that is how much space there is for growth in that regional integration. But also, just generally, well, Africa, someone mentioned yesterday, makes 25% of the members of the WTO. There's no correlation with that, but it's interesting to see also that it's also only 3% of the value of trade that is traded in under WTO rules. So it really remains very much behind. So I'd say, of course, the frameworks matter for that, to enable that integration. And these discussions that we're having here will have a bearing in the possibilities of furthering that integration. But one of the things that is very important is to understand what is coming up with the changes in the economy, in the global economy. And so again, I go back to making sure that that integration is also done, thinking about what are the opportunities that are now offered to Africa, for instance, from new technologies. So something we haven't talked about generally for the trade system as a challenge is how the rules that have been put in place, the negotiations of the past 20 years that have privileged basically trying to facilitate supply chains, corporate supply chains, and national treatment for foreign investment are now challenged by the cloud, by the 3D printing, by the kind of issues that Jonathan Frieda spoke before, how anybody anywhere can now participate in international trade. And so looking ahead, look with a future, with a vision of the future, is what you need when you try to accommodate these economies now into regional and global integration, I think.
We've had, I think you agree, a wonderful set of reflections at precisely poignant moment for the WTO here at the beginning of the week in Nairobi. These reflections, I think, have prompted us to think about an expanded and wider role, even a reconceptualized role for what the WTO can contribute to the international regime in this regard. And that thinking has invited us, even with all of the immediacy,
to try to conclude this week with a credible outcome. It has nevertheless encouraged us to think much more structurally and systemically and longer term. It has, however, focused mainly on the what, not so much on the how. And for the how, if you're interested, again, I invite you to go to some of the specific sessions here at the Trade and Development Symposium. I'm doing your work for you here, Ricardo, because you will hear some of the concrete proposals from those experts in those different groups that are answering the question, how, on many of the themes that we've addressed here in the panel today. Last, can I invite you to join me in applauding our panel of wonderful thinkers? And I wish you a good week here in Nairobi.